It's time for the Other Mike and Mike Show. This week we will talk about staying happy through adversity, trips we are trying to decide on in the near future, and of course bizarre news from throughout the land. Also we will throw a little walking deaf at you, so join us in a cold beverage, dip the shoulder and look away from the light. The Other Mike and Mike Show starts now. Bitches.
Yo, man, can you make some lemonade for the fellas? Yo, could I get a cold beverage? I need some lemonade. A sweaty outside, the lemonade will be nice. A swipe on the top to a big check. Yo, I'm about to a drink by that girl's got the bay on the phone for me.
Yo, I can go for a cold beverage.
I can always go for a cold beverage.
I'm drinking a nice Bloody Mary, number three, right here. I got the hat trick of Absolute going on.
Nice. I got some water, but that's about it.
Fail. Anyway, welcome to the Other Mike and Mike Show. I'm Mike W.
And I'm Mike T.
It's episode 25.
I think so.
God damn it. We were supposed to have... I was going to try to get my pals, Greg and Josh, to come do that. It didn't seem to work out, but I would like to plan for all of us to do a birthday show, if you're down. Maybe us either meeting out by you or figure out how to do that. I have my birthday's in a couple weeks, so...
Yeah, no, I mean, I would be totally up for it.
So whether we do it at Mohegan Sun or something like that, we'll figure it out. How you been?
Good, man. You know, living a dream. Working, sleeping, working, sleeping. That's about it.
Yeah, that's all I'm doing, too.
Yeah.
Got some legal issues, too. Did I tell you about that?
I don't think so.
Oh, it's a disaster. It's just an absolute disaster. Just some people just don't know the law, and it looks like I'm going to head to court. So,
landlord stuff.
Yeah, it's just completely out of his mind, completely wrong, and yeah, just whatever. Just okay. There's only so many times you can make fun of me and the attorney. You're dead wrong. So,
right. Yeah, I mean, if he wants a little piece of that action, then
yeah, you know, I never thought it would get to that. I mean, I used the Palomine to show him the meaning of his world, as far as the pretenders go.
Right.
And he still won't take it for an answer. So now, you know, I work for one of the largest law firms in the world. I went and talked to one of my pals, and they were just like, he's out of his fucking mind.
Yeah.
Let him take you to court. Then you count it to him for the world.
Yeah, if he wants to if he wants to go to war, you will politely oblige him.
Yeah, I had no reason to go to war. I tried to throw a rock with a friend of mine, and he threw a boulder back, so I got to arm the nukes. Where's Matthew Broderick in War Games? Would you like to play a nice game of chess?
That was a great movie.
Terrific movie.
Yep.
Wasn't Ally Sheedy in that movie, too?
I think so.
Wow. You know, I had an Ally Sheedy moment.
Really?
It was strange, right?
Yeah.
Ally Sheedy dated Richie Sambora in the 80s, who was the guitar player for Bon Jovi until they had a lover's quarrel, broke up. And side note, I was never into that type of music. I think we've talked about that in the past. That not my cup of tea. My wife, total glam music, rock and roll chick, and I was a jazz cat and loved ska music and swing, big band.
Right.
Which I still do. And back then I was, or punk, I was really big into the Clash and stuff, but I wasn't feeling any of that, you know, Bon Jovi and nonsense back in the day. And when he used to come to my house, Richie Sambora, and I have no autographs, had no interest, I'm just like, yeah, he's a tool. And he wasn't there to see me, he was there to see my dad, because he used to write a humongous check. Because he lived in our town, he had a huge estate in our town, he used to write a huge check to the cops for Special Olympics.
Oh, okay.
So very cool. He used to come by, talk to my dad. Very, very cool dude. But he was dating her, and I worked at the ice cream parlor when I was in high school, and they came in and ordered a chocolate shake, and she went and put the straw in it and didn't hit the lid properly, and the thing exploded all over the counter, hit me, hit her. And they were both laughing. I went out and cleaned it up like a toolbox and made him a new one. But that was my interaction with Ally Sheedy and Richie Sambora.
Nice.
Fail. Absolute fail. I did nothing disgusting to it either. I was nothing but up and up. I would never fuck with somebody's food or anything like that if I was, you know, while I was in that service industry.
Right. Yeah, that's one thing. Oh, man, that's one thing I've... Like, growing up, I've been in the food industry, you know, like when I was in high school. And also, like, a little bit, I bartend for a little while, like, after getting out of the military until I found a job. And, like, I've seen people fuck with other people's food. But me, personally, I've never done it. I just can't do it.
Yeah, I can't do it.
Like, I know how I would feel if it happened to me, right? Like, I would flip my shit and, you know, like that movie Waiting. You ever see that movie Waiting,
oh,
right?
Oh, my God. With Ryan Reynolds?
Oh my God, terrible. Man. It like scares the shit out of me. You know, so I would never do anything like that.
But even if you look at the movie like Road Trip, when DJ Qualls gets his French toast tossed in the air and the fat dude catching the sweatpants just gassing right. like a mofo.
Right.
That's disgusting.
It is. It's disgusting. It makes me kind of sick to my stomach.
Yeah, so I would never mess with somebody's grub.
No.
Anyway, so let's talk a little staying happy through adversity. You know, just dealing with all these legal issues and other stuff going on. Just so stressed out in the normal day, like in work. And a lot has gone on the past month, moving to a place I'm not so happy that I moved to.
Right.
I like the fact that I'm saving money, but I haven't saved any money yet because I'm still dealing with legal issues. So it's like my money's still funneling out the window.
Right.
And hopefully a week from, not even a week, 6 days, I'm going to Dallas. I'm going to go see UFC 185. My boy Chuck got tickets, so I could use the break.
Now, if there's any way to feel better about life, that's to do a little mini mancation, get away from it all, go, you know, go see some fights, hang out with good buddies, shoulder dip a little bit, and you come back refreshed and ready to,
shoulder dip a little bit. He bought four bottles of Makers.
Oh, okay. Well, shoulder dip a lot.
Yeah, that's going to be rough.
Yeah.
You're right, though. And, of course, I'm going to say close the curtain because I want to see you. Got to sit in front of the plane.
Right.
You know, especially it's just me. I mean, no way I'm sitting back in the cattle.
Oh, no.
I'll be hammered before coast. I told us I'll be hammered when I land because I got a layover on the way out. I never do a layover. But I couldn't get a good time in the morning to get there. He wanted me to get there sometime in the mid-afternoon, like around 3:30. The only way I could do is do a stop. It's only like a 45-minute stop. I just got to change gates in, like, Ohio somewhere.
Oh, okay.
Which is fine because then I go right back to the front of the plane and keep drinking.
Right.
I don't mind. I'm only bringing like a duffel bag. It's not like I'm only going for a day and a half.
Yeah, you're flying down there Saturday, right? Or Friday?
Friday morning.
All right. Friday morning, then come back Sunday.
Correct.
All right.
Got like a noon flight or something coming home Sunday.
Well, that'll be fun, though.
Yeah, it'll be great.
It'll free your mind, right? Like it'll give you nothing to think about for a weekend. Sometimes that's what we need.
Anything to make you happy.
Absolutely. Huh, because I'm happy. Clap along
if you feel like a room without a roof. You like that song?
No. Because I'm happy. Clap along if
you feel like happiness is the truth. You really don't like that song?
No, but because I'm happy. But even if I hear it though, I still bob my head to it. Right.
I don't know why that is. That's like why you have to urinate when you're taking a deuce.
Right. It's just natural. It just goes with the territory.
To do it.
You take a shit, you're going to piss. You listen to...
Happy, you're going to bob your head, and you're going to smile. If you know what happiness is to you. Even if you don't smile, you got to move your head.
You definitely. Or like tap your fingers on the steering wheel like when you're driving. You're doing something when that song pops on.
I was going to stop by one of the dopey hats,
the Arby's hats?
Exactly. The Smokey the Bear Arby's hat.
Yeah.
Serves like fries with that.
That's atrocious.
Awful. And they sell them at like Paul Stewart and like high-end men's stores now.
Yeah, and they're not cheap.
No. No, not cheap.
No, not at all. And I don't understand why anybody would wear something like that.
I mean, it's crazy expensive.
Yeah, and it's crazy awful.
Ah, you think?
The only thing that I can really see you using it for in case you have to take an emergency shit. You can just take it off your head, take a big shit in it, and throw it away. That's about the only thing that I could see you that happening.
I don't know, man. That's a lot of money to be throwing away taking a deuce in your hat.
Well, I wouldn't be buying it to begin with, you know, but...
I would if I was a park ranger.
Yeah, that's about it. Yeah, but then your park ranger hat is going to cost you a fifth of what that hat. Actually, you're probably not even going to have to pay for your park ranger hat. They're just going to give it to you along with your uniform.
Well, then I'll just take the front off and I'll just sing Happy by Pharrell and think that I'm a rock star. Yeah. 16 times I moved my shoulders during that clip. Can't help it.
Yeah, I know. The screws in screws in the bottom of my chair now are a little loose because I'm rocking back and forth.
Can't help it.
Oh, can't help it.
But that's like one of the things that we need to talk about is just trying to stay happy when shit gets bad because everybody goes through some bad shit.
Right.
And what's it going to do? We're all going to, at the end of the day, someday we're all going to croak. why stress yourself out? I mean, there's only a handful of things you should really stress yourself out over. And even them. Like, I used to sit in the corner and rock and just, like, I'd, like, cut up Xanax and snort it. And I don't do that no more. Now I got a bunch of bottles of booze. I shrug my shoulders. I'm not going to stop the freight train if the bad freight train's coming. Maybe I'll jump on the side of it with my hobo gear and take a ride.
Yeah. Like, people actually get mad at me sometimes. Like, my wife being probably the main one of getting mad at me. Because, like, when something happens or there's, like, a serious situation, but it's not so serious, but you're blowing it up out of proportion to be ridiculously serious. Like, I don't give a fuck. You know what I mean? Like, I just don't – I don't let it bother me. You know, I'll throw on some TV or I'll go out and I'll do something and, you know, I'll go to the casino. I'll play a little bit of blackjack and I forget all about it. You know, like if, you know, my wife comes home and had a little bit of problem at work, I'm just like, you know, like she gets mad sometimes. I'm like, who gives a fuck? I'm like, you're home. Mm-hmm. I'm like, don't let it bother you. Don't, you know, if you have like an argument with somebody at work or this and this, I'm like, fuck them.
Let it go.
Just don't answer them back. Don't talk to them. Don't think about it. You know, and then she'll bring it up like 30 more times throughout the night. Like, keep talking about this person. I'm like, look what you're doing to yourself.
You're making yourself crazy. You're getting an ulcer.
Right. Like, quit fucking talking about this person. Just shut up. You know, she's like, oh, wow, it's so easy for you. You know, I just want to vent. I'm like, well, no. I'm like, venting is one thing. And it's just one time talking about it. And then you move on to the next thing. You're dwelling on it. You're making yourself, you know.
Crazy.
Crazy is a great word, right? And, you know, you're getting more and more and more and more pissed off. I'm like, just
chill out.
That bitch is crazy.
I'm like, let's go do something. Let's get out of here. Let's go do something. Let's get a couple drinks and some dinner or something. Oh, no. All right. Well, you know, but.
That's it. Relax.
I have a great skill of not giving a fuck. You know, I've been called apathetic on numerous occasions, but I don't think it's that. I don't let the small shit bother me.
I used to the point where it would make me unhealthy.
Right.
You know what changed? I worked for, like I said, an enormous law firm, which will name unnamed because I'm sure they frown upon this.
Right.
But there's a very important partner. I mean, we have 150 partners, 700 associates just in New York. And one of the partners, big deal dude, you know, you and I could never afford him in 100 lifetimes.
Right.
And a problem happened. And I caught the problem, and I approached him, and I was like, oh, my God, this guy's going to fucking lose his mind. And I said, yo, Mr. Such and Such, listen, this is what happened. He's not much older than me, but the guy, you know, earns millions.
Right.
And I said, listen, oh, my God, this happened. I'm sorry this happened. This won't happen again. And he looked at me and said, you know, you're always as important as the smallest thing that bothered you, and if this thing bothered me, I wouldn't be that important. And it kind of stunned me. And I said, holy shit, you're the man. I was like, all right. And he was like, I appreciate you letting me know. Now I know that what steps need to be taken, but I'm not going to sweat it. And I was stunned. And I was like, you know, that's a philosophy we should all live by.
Right.
If I'm letting that bother me, my life's a mess.
Absolutely.
He could care less. He's like, listen, I got fat checks to cash. And I got to protect the 1%.
Right.
Go, you know, good day.
Yeah.
Take care. It's okay. Thank you.
Right.
So I try not to stress it out, but there's been so much stuff going on here. And the other thing that stresses me out, too, is just, like, you know, when times get tough, you know who your pals are.
Yeah.
Like, when you go through some shit, you know who's cool and who still reaches out and who's still talking to you or says, yo, man, if you need anything, let me know.
Right. I have, like, 3 of those, maybe 4.
Yeah, I'm lucky if I have 3 or 4 of those.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the ones that used to be that for years are just have disappeared.
Right.
And I've cut them out completely. I mean, it's just like retards. And it's funny how time goes on and things change. It's just the most bizarre. I'd rather fly to another country for a cocktail than hang out with my neighbor.
Yeah, I mean, same here. It's, you know, like things used to bother me too, right? Like the small things. And, you know, like I've been in situations before to where, you know, like you said, like it would literally make me unhealthy. You know, I would drive myself batshit crazy. Just right. Thinking, like, you know. And then now when I look back, I'm like, man, it really was not. It's not a big deal. And, you know, as I got older and moved around in life and surrounded myself with, somewhat intelligent people, my outlook on things changed. My thought process changed. And I just realized, I'm like, Jesus, it's really not that bad.
Exactly.
Like, my shoulders up.
There it is. I was watching him the other day, man. He's just hilarious.
Bill Burr is great.
Yeah. But no, it's
no reason to get yourself all worked up over.
Correct. And, you know, everything that happened not too long ago with me, like, you know, I'm not going to talk about it publicly, but, you know, there was some shit that happened and I was going crazy about it for a little bit.
I felt bad for you.
Right.
I was like, there's no reason to drive yourself nuts.
Right. And we talked about it, you know, like as friends and, you know, you talked about it. I talked about it, you know, and as time passed, I was like, fuck, you know, like that was one thing that I let bother me for a little bit. And
you think
more than a little bit, you know, I was fucking furious. But as time went by, I'm like, man, fuck this. You know, I got better things to do. You know,
True.
You know, I got to put my focus on shit that actually matters and shit that's coming up and shit that actually affects my life now. You know what I mean? I can't be worrying about these fucking nonsense people and what they do and whatever. You freaking know what I mean? And
right.
You know, in the words of Gloria Estefan, the rhythm is going to get you some fucking day. You know, but.
Or you put them on the bucket list.
I've
talked about that. I'm going to write that screenplay and sell it.
What's that?
Where I have a list. I have a list of 10 people that I will kill before I leave the earth.
Oh.
Like if I ever get stage 4 cancer, those 10 people are dead. They're going to go in the ground before I do. I think that'd make a great movie.
It would make a great movie.
Right? Great horror movie or a great just suspense movie. Just
an average dude,
you know, average job, never had trouble with the law. Always a stand-up citizen, tries to do the right thing.
Gets diagnosed with cancer, has got a month to live.
The 10 people that did me wrong that I've never forgiven, I will fucking kill you.
Yeah. Man, I like it.
And I've told one of them. One of them I said, one day I will come back for you and it'll be a flash and I'll go black.
Like the end of The Sopranos.
And you'll just never know. Right, exactly. You'll never know I was there.
Right.
I will stalk you.
Right. You'll be eating fucking onion rings in a diner one day and...
It won't even be that. You'll be coming somewhere. It'll have to be with nobody around, or I'll just be sitting in your living room waiting for you when you come home.
Right.
And I'll put 3 in the kill zone, just walk out. Maybe take an apple or something on the way out.
No, that's actually excellent.
Yeah, it's actually bizarre. I've told the therapist about that for years, and it still won't go away. That's the one thing that won't go away. There's these 10 people, and it changes as time goes on, and somebody gets knocked out of the 10, you know, the 10 or the 8 spot or something, you know, how... Somebody loses, somebody wins big.
Right.
You got to move them up.
Right. Right. Yeah, I mean, there's a, you know, I mean, I can list 5 quickly. And it probably wouldn't take me long to come up with the other 5 either.
And the reason I got to that list, too, is when, and think about it, you know your 5, put them in your head, especially the 1 or 2.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
When the therapist says, well, how do you get them out of your head? What is something that'll make you not think about them? And I said, I'll not think about them when the warmth of their blood sprays me in the face. And I see their soul just disappear from the lifeless carcass. And the therapist's like, you know, I'd like you to see somebody else. A wackadoo. So I'm not a wackadoo. I'm as sane as they come. It's just the truth.
Right. And you know what? Like what we're talking about right now, and a therapist can sit there and tell you that you're crazy, or somebody can tell you that you're crazy. I'm quite confident that most people think like that, and they think that, you know, I'd love to kill these fucking people, and someday if I had the opportunity, I just may. Especially, as you said, you're diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. You have 30 days to live regardless. They aren't, you know, there's no, like, clinical trials that they can put you in. There's no, you know, like, you're dead in 30 fucking days.
Yeah, you're dead. I'm coming up on you.
I'm coming for you. There's no doubt about it. What the fuck are they going to do?
What are they going to do? And I have the arsenal ready, which is even... I premeditated that shit. I got the Glock, the silencer, the extended clips. I'm insane. Bowie knife.
I'll be dead before I go to court.
Yeah, exactly right. You better see how many of the 10 that you can stop me from.
Yeah.
Like, what's the over-under of the amount I take out?
Yeah, right.
Can I get all 10? That's where the movie comes in. That's amazing, because you know you're going to get the first three or four before somebody catches on if there's a pattern.
Absolutely.
I don't know. It's something to think about.
Yeah, no, it's...
Obviously, I think about it a lot. I'm a little off.
Yeah, I mean, now that you're bringing it up, I'm, like, thinking about it more than what I have in the past. But, like, you know, this incident has made me, like, dude, like, I hope, like, this motherfucker's plane crashes. You know?
Tell me how you really feel.
You know, or, like, someday... Well, no, I don't want to do a plane crash because there's probably great people on the plane with, you know, these people. But, like, you know, walking out his front door one day... And he slips on the ice and a fucking car comes. You know what I mean? And, you know, turns his head into scanners and...
Just explodes.
Just explodes. It's like, huh.
Or better yet, how about 127 hours, but nobody comes and visits you and you can't get your arm off?
Right.
We just rot and like a bird comes and just eats your eyeballs.
Yeah. Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, people listen like, these fucking guys are...
Wackadoos.
Problems like I'm gonna, you know, like the cops and the feds are gonna be showing up at our doorsteps because we're talking about killing people. But
good luck proving it.
Yeah. No, well, I mean, oh yeah. Well, I mean, it's recorded. But
yeah, we're joking around.
Yeah. Yeah. No, for sure. But but yeah, like, you know, but I think that this is where me being apathetic would come in, because like I wouldn't give a shit.
No, I wouldn't either.
I really wouldn't. Like, I would probably be like, hey, honey, you want to go out to dinner tonight? You know what I mean? And do some shots and drink some beers. And
Let me wash this blood off, and we'll bleach the tub, and then we'll go get some steak.
Yeah. Or, you know, even if it just happened by itself, I'd probably go out, and I'd probably celebrate.
I tell you, I think I found my walkout song.
Oh, yeah?
I think if I ever was like, if I had my own walkout music, this would be it.
Everyone knows you're crazy, and they're probably right. Everyone knows you're crazy, now it's out in the light.
That's it, man.
And everyone knows you're crazy, everyone knows that you're crazy now.
Dude, that's my, I'd be strutting to that.
Right?
I'd be strutting that by putting on the silencer.
Yeah, like I would, it's just.
I still have a pair of my dad's sap gloves that I stole when I was in eighth grade.
Yeah?
My dad used to have Riot sap gloves, and I remember he couldn't find them. And I still have them. Everybody doesn't know what that is. They're gloves that go up to the forearm, but the whole front where you make the fist of knuckle are loaded with tree sap, so you can punch your hand through a wall if you wanted to. So, I mean, when you hit somebody with that, you have to break a bone in their face.
Right.
They're amazing. Absolutely amazing.
I don't think I've ever heard of them, to be honest with you.
Yeah, full tree sap. So the whole knuckle in front, full tree sap. And it's like, it's about a half inch thick. I mean, it's insane. They're illegal, obviously.
Right.
You'll never find them. But I know where they are. That's what you put, you know, normal people just put gloves on because they don't want to leave fingerprints.
Right.
Crazy people, we put on sap gloves because just in case we run out of ammo and we want to break a bone before we go down.
Right, right, right. Yeah, like I would love to put one of those on and just run full force to just launch all my weight.
Superman punch.
Just right near the fucking side of the temple.
You don't even have to. You can. I mean, you look at these things and put them on, it's insane. I can put my hand right through a wall. They're right. Insane.
Right.
I don't even know if they make them anymore. I mean, this is, God, I'm getting old. I mean, I stole these when... Shit. 1982? 1983? Crazy. Fail. Anyway, let's move on before people are like going to want to have Bellevue commit us.
So back to not letting things bother us.
Yeah, now that we just killed half the universe.
Yeah, right. You know, 20 people are now dead in our minds, but, you know, we don't let the small, you know, we don't let the small stuff bother us.
No, Mike and I are both happy.
It's the truth, because I'm happy.
So let's make fun of deaf people.
Okay.
How about Sean Forbes sings I'm Deaf? Oh. For the next 30 seconds, we're going to do The Walking Deaf. For the people that remember me from Knights of the Clown Table, we were asked to bring it back. So what we do is we play clips of The Walking Deaf, Dead, and we translate it to the deaf people. There you get Walking Deaf. It don't matter. People, and for the hate mail, don't bother to hate mail, because the people that would be offended by this can't hear it anyway. So here's a little clip from this week's Walking Dead, and I will translate it for all of our deaf fans or Matt Hamill.
You tied up walkers.
He killed our friend.
I'm not having this conversation. You obey my orders out there.
Well, then we're just as screwed as your last run crew.
Say that again.
You'll back off, Aiden.
Come on, Max. Take a step back.
Come on, tough guy.
No one's impressed, man. Look away.
Hey! What is going on?
This guy's got a problem with the way we do things.
Let these people in, because we actually know what we're doing out there.
Hey, that's enough! I said that is enough!
Jesus Christ. Anyway. So.
And we're now officially on a dying deaf man's bucket list.
And to translate what Mike just said to our deaf friends. There we go. So that's a little bit of Walking Deaf. Actually, I know that you haven't been liking The Walking Dead.
Actually, the last two episodes I liked.
Oh, okay.
It's giving me more story now. There's more story. It's
interesting, right?
It's so fucking slow, dude. It's this season, besides the last couple episodes, have been awful. And now I have a feeling the rest of this season is not going to be good.
Let me ask you a question.
Sure.
If you're AMC.
Right.
And you get 25 million people sitting in a week watching this show, loving this show, obsessing over this show. How many stories can you tell about zombies? I would draw that shit out. There's only so many storylines it could go, right?
Right. Well, I mean, and that's what they're doing. They're dragging it out. They're going to drag it out until the ratings start to go down to the point to where they'll fucking end it. But
the ratings are still through the roof.
Through the roof. You're right. And it's not that I still watch it. I'm not like protesting the show. I'm not like stopping, you know, I'm not going to like stop watching it. I enjoyed the last couple of episodes. They kept me interested. But for the most part, it's been putting me to sleep. And I have a feeling the rest of this season is going to put me to fucking sleep
no,
too.
No. You know?
I mean, maybe some cool shit will happen, but I have a feeling
it already did. They shaved Rick and made him shirtless.
Oh, okay, yeah.
It was amazing.
Well, speaking of shaving, again, we talked about this again, and your wife actually posted about it as well.
She did?
How the fuck is Rick the only one with a scruffy beard?
That's a good point. How come they don't look like ZZ Top?
Every single person on there is clean shaven. The women's armpits are clean shaven.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
Come on, man. Everybody gets haircuts for some reason. Nobody's hair is getting any longer.
Did they go out and find tampons through this season?
Right. The baby's not aging.
Yeah, the baby's been – the baby should be like Carl's age at this point.
I know. Like that's what I'm saying. Like, that's how slow the fucking progression is, dude. Unless
– was there no winter?
Yeah. I mean, well, I guess the Asian kid wouldn't really get much facial hair, but –
yeah, because Asians can't grow hair. They can't drive. They can't fly planes.
And they can't grow facial hair.
And they can't grow facial hair.
Right. But other than that, everybody else should be looking like fucking, you know, it's ridiculous.
You should look like ZZ Top meets Naked and Afraid.
And they probably smell like a dumpster.
Oh, got to.
Well, not anymore, because they got the shower. But prior
Daryl
to.
Daryl didn't. Daryl won't shower.
No, Daryl's still sitting on a nice front porch. Fucking cutting animals open, leaving bloodstains.
Boondock Saints.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, I think about this, you know, like that's the kind of stuff that I think about when I watch it. It's like, dude, like, can you imagine how bad these people smell?
All right, so if it's not Walking Dead, but I still think it's good. I think the way they ended it last week, and I'll see this week, is when Rick said, well, if it doesn't go our way, we'll just take the town over.
Right, and I like it. And like I said, the last two episodes have intrigued me. If it's kept me interested and awake. But I'm telling you right now, Better Call Saul is blowing it away.
Oh, I love that show too, but different.
It's different. It's much different, you know. But I now find myself looking more forward to that on a weekly basis than The Walking Dead.
I look forward to the two of them, but the show that blows them both away is House of Cards.
I got to watch that.
It's the greatest show I've ever seen.
It's on Netflix, right?
It's amazing. Like, I'm obsessed. That's the only show that I'll watch and never pick up my tablet, phone, and I don't blink.
Right.
Kevin Spacey's so good in that, man.
Yeah. Yeah, I've heard so many good things about it, and I've yet to watch it. Like a year ago, maybe, I started watching it. Like, I watched the season one, episode one, like, where he kills the dog, right? Like, when the show, like, first starts.
Right.
And then, like, I got sidetracked doing something. I forget what I did. Like, I left or got sidetracked, and then I just never watched it again. But now that I...
He's ruthless, dude.
Right. Now that I'm hearing this again, I need to watch it, I think.
Here, I'll play a small clip of Frank Underwood. He's so good.
And that's Kevin Spacey's character.
Kevin Spacey, exactly. Whenever decides to start.
And the butchery begins. Any pugilist worth his salt knows when someone's on the ropes, that's when you throw a combination to the gut and a left hook to the jaw. In Gaffney, we had our own brand of diplomacy. Shake with your right hand, but hold a rock in your left. I've always loathed the necessity of sleep. Like death, it puts even the most powerful men on their backs. The heart can choke the mind when all its blood flows back unto itself. There can be no false steps now. The higher up the mountain, the more treacherous the path. Good things happen to good people.
Avoid wars you can't win and never raise your flag for an asinine cause like slavery.
When the money's coming your way, you don't ask any questions.
This hurts us both, but it's not my wound to suture. Claire must be the surgeon. Only she can stop the bleeding.
The road to power is paved with hypocrisy and casualties.
I mean, he's awesome.
Yeah, well, he's awesome. A great actor to begin with.
He's so good in this. What I love about this is that he'll just look at the camera and say these things. Like, while they're going on, that's what makes it so unique. And his road to become president and who he runs over and has to kill and how his wife is, it's out of control. But when he looks at the camera and just says the crazy quotes...
Never regret. It's not beginning the story that I fear. It's not knowing how it will end. Everyone is fair game now. There are two types of vice presidents, doormats and matadors. Which do you think I intend to be? The only thing more satisfying than convincing someone to do what I want is failing to persuade them on purpose. It's like a do not enter sign. It just begs you to walk through the door.
From the lion's den to a pack of wolves. When you're fresh meat, kill and throw them something fresher.
He's awesome.
And also, like, I love how they do it. Like, don't they, like, record the whole season and then, like, release the whole season at once?
Yeah, we've blown through 8 episodes in, like, 2 days.
Yeah, like, I think it's awesome how they're doing that with, like, Netflix. Like, it's a Netflix exclusive. They do the whole season. They release the whole season. And then... What do they do? Do they do one season a year or?
Yeah, it's like every March or February the year comes out.
And what are they on now? It's 2, 3?
Three, season 3.
Okay.
But it's so good. He's so good at it. He's so good at it.
Well, now I know what I'm going to do today and tomorrow.
And then when he looks at the camera, like, and this is now we're in season 3, he goes through some bullshit. And he looks at the camera and goes, so there you are. And then one time he's saying it was Supreme Court just in the room, and he walks away from him, he's pissed, and he looks at the camera and talks, and the Supreme Court says, sir, are you talking to me? And he's talking to us. I mean, it's awesome.
Awesome.
He's awesome.
Yeah.
I love me some Spacey, but dealing with the Russians, I mean, it's just it's just showing you the politics, and if anybody out there does not watch that, you're out of your fucking mind. It's worth the $7, $8 a month for Netflix just to watch that show.
Right. Right. Yeah. Well, like, speak another great show too. Like, I don't want to go here we are talking about shows again for 10-15 minutes.
That's fine.
Have you seen The Blacklist yet?
It's one of my favorites.
Oh my god, dude!
Red.
He. It's
First of all, he was Steph in Pretty in Pink. How is that bad?
Yes. I bet. Now, come to think about it and bringing that up, I think I look forward to that show more than any other show on a weekly basis.
Maybe a show that's on regular television.
Regular television, right.
That or Better Call Saul. But I'd rather watch Netflix.
Yeah.
I'd rather watch this. I watched The Fall with Gillian Anderson. If anybody's a Gillian Anderson fan out there, you know who's a Gillian Anderson fan is my pal Josh, Sir Ninja Turtles. That movie's great. First of all, she's a sex scene in it where she's just destroying this guy from the top. It's like a great cowgirl scene. Just to see Gillian Anderson do that, it's worth Netflix. And they all have a brogue. It's set in like, she's like Irish, but she's in like England or something on a murder case, and she's like a head detective.
Oh, okay.
But she looks great. She's aged well. She's a little whorish in this. You just got a little bit of that Kat Zingano skank.
Oh, yeah.
But at the same time, she's hot. But like, I watched that. Peaky Blinders is another one. If you like Boardwalk Empires, you'll like that because it's set right after World War One. It's set in over in Ireland where they're the mob.
Oh, nice. I love mob shows.
Cillian Murphy from Red Eye.
Right.
Great. These little tiny great shows, man, that I watch on there that are just – I mean, I caught up. I saw the season 1-3 on Hell on Wheels, which was amazing. Common in it. About putting the railroad down right after the Civil War.
Okay.
Just like cool stuff that you can watch on Netflix. The Killing. Netflix should be paying us for this.
Yeah, I think I know, right? Maybe I'll bluff to reach out to Netflix's marketing division. Like, look, bro, give us like a dollar. Give us a code.
Yeah.
A dollar every time we get somebody to sign up with that code.
Or just give me a free month.
Yeah, right. Just give us free Netflix and we'll talk, and we'll talk about it.
We'll blow Netflix.
Yeah. But no, like you say that, it's making me want to get into it now and search around a little bit. Like one day I had like a documentary day. Like I like had like a website up, like the best, like the top 10 documentaries on Netflix.
Right.
And like that's what I did all day. And because I love documentaries, man. I'm kind of like a weirdo. You know what I mean?
I like documentaries too. Ken Burns.
Yeah, like I love knowledge. I love watching, things like that. And
I'll tell you, what you should check out if you haven't already is Vice on HBO.
I haven't seen that yet.
Oh my God, it's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. This guy is from Brooklyn. He goes all over the world and he'll sit with like ISIS. I mean, he'll go into the most craziest situations and he'll get to the point where like at one point he was in somebody's house. He's like, I can't even say that. He's telling the camera like, we're going to violate some kind of rule and get killed here. We have to really be careful what we talk about.
And this is real, right? It's not scripted?
No, it's real. It's just like he has his little headquarters out of his apartment in Brooklyn, and HBO picked it up. And I watched them on demand, and I was just glassed over. My eyes were just glassing over how amazing it was.
I'll have to check that out, too.
But make sure you check out House of Cards.
Yeah, I definitely will. And I'm also going to pitch a reality series to a network soon about working where I work.
Oh, that's an amazing idea.
And just like in the warehouse and like what goes on in there. And
here's another idea. You and I interviewing people on Access TV, but we interview actors as the role, not as the actor.
Right.
So we can interview Kevin Spacey as Frank Underwood. So we're interviewing Frank Underwood.
That'd be excellent.
Access might buy that.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there's some pretty poor programming on that station.
Terrible.
So.
But they give people shows. I mean, it's like three steps below MTV2.
Right.
But like, we can get on there. Why not give us like a budget of like a grand? We'll get hammered with some B celebrity at a bar at like a Tilted Kilt in Wilkes Bar, and film it.
We'll call it Hammered With.
Hammered with Mike and Mike.
Yeah. Well, no, just Hammered With. And then whoever the guest is at that point in time. Hammered with Frank Underwood.
Cheers.
Yeah.
Can't we be Cheers? Was there ever a show called Cheers?
What?
I don't think that's ever taken.
No.
Let's run that out there. Anyway, so let's move on. We're going to talk a little bit about some trips that we're talking about taking. Obviously, I'm going to Dallas on Friday. I was thinking that we have to get, like I said, we got to get Josh and Greg either out to the Mohegan Sun or somewhere out by you. We could do a show. They sent me a picture yesterday. They were drinking for Greg's wife, Betty's birthday. And it's just like, man, I was so jealous. It's like, I wish I lived closer to those guys.
Right.
Just so we could just shoulder dip in the greatness of life.
Yeah. I mean, I wish I had more people around here. Like like you said, like I have one guy around here. He's a really good friend of mine, but I don't get to see him often. I just wish my wife wanted to do more things. But
No, I get that. It's not my wife either. It's just like I don't have many pals that either like to shoulder dip or like to gamble or like to watch hockey or MMA. It's not my limit. My scope is limited. NFL. It's like my interest at this point in my life is so small. And the things that other people are interested in are just, to me, retarded.
Right. And I just don't relate to it. Like I have no.
Exactly.
I have no interest, like any interest in like what they do. And it's just like, I'd rather just stay home.
Yeah, not interested. I'd rather sit around and play, you know, gin, or I'll play cards, even if it's for low stake penny cards while I'm drinking some Jameson.
Yeah, like I'd rather go play. Blackjack. I'd rather take a little bit of money and go play some blackjack for a while than go do this. Know what I mean?
Absolutely, or just play a home game.
Right.
Where you guys are shooting the breeze and, or just listening to some rock music.
That's a good time to me. That's my idea of
Trivial Pursuit. You play some board games and teams.
Yeah.
Getting hammered.
Yeah. I mean, we just did that. I told you like not too long ago. Like we had another couple came over and we sat here and we drank and we played board games.
Yeah, we got to do that. Even if it's if we come out or we all go to the house in the country. Because every time we go up there, you know the Connecticut folks will come out.
Right.
The army of... The Army of Torrington. There's like 7 people that live there, and I know like 6 of them.
Right. Yeah, it'd be awesome.
Oh, terrific. And they're awesome people. These are the brotherhood of kayak, so it'd be great.
Right. Absolutely.
So other trips I'm looking at taking. Obviously, I would like to hit Busch Gardens this summer. Whether or not I'm going to get a chance to do it or not, I don't know. It's been a while since I've been there. I'm trying to do just a couple things with the kids. We're looking at going to California.
Okay.
I went out there last year. I want to go down to the barbecue. If you want to put that on the calendar, I'm going to go down to a barbecue, I think, in August. I think it's August, but I don't have the dates yet. They don't have the dates, but they're going to have a big bonfire barbecue. They shoot guns, a bunch of my KISS pals down in their compound in Houston.
Oh, nice.
And then they're going to take a bus to Dallas so we can hang out with Chuck, and they're going to go to the opening of Rockin' Brews or something there.
Yeah, there's 2 weekends in August that I know for sure that, like, my cousin's getting married one of those weekends, and another weekend will be my wife's and mine anniversary weekend.
Okay, so if you want to make excuses already, that's fine. It's fine.
Excuses, come on, man.
Like, I understand. Lay the groundwork early. I get it.
Oh, yeah. I am not avoiding. I am not making excuses here. It's my wife's anniversary and birthday in the same fucking week. And
dude, I had Valentine's, my wife's birthday, and I didn't do a jack.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't.
She got nothing. I didn't even get a card.
Right.
I gave her a pat on the back, said, happy birthday.
Right. And maybe for the next anniversary, you know, like once we get to like 3, 4, 5 years, it might end up that way. But for the first couple, you know, whatever.
It's the first 15 for me.
But the wedding, I definitely got to go to. Well, I mean, I guess I don't have too much.
I have never been. I went to one wedding since 2003, and it was for a pal at work who asked me to go. And otherwise, I refuse to go. I hate weddings. I think everyone should elope.
And I'm going to the reception that's in the middle of the woods.
I would never go.
With 37 kegs.
I don't think I'd go.
Oh, it's going to be excellent.
I don't like people. I mean, if it was like... you and you said, listen, I want you to come out and shoulder dip. It's different. But it's like if it's an acquaintance or a cousin, I'm not interested.
Right.
Has anything to do with me? I'll never step foot in a church. No. Not going. I'll go pay my respects to the dead at my leisure. They're dead. It's terrible, I know. But it's just it's a weird quirk with me. I don't like organized religion. And
me either.
I don't like marriage. I mean, I like marriage. I don't like the whole pomp and circumstance. Like, my wife's the same way. If we would have done it again, if we could turn back time and play some Cher, we would have gone to Vegas.
Right. No, man, I'm freaking not going to the wedding. I'm going to the reception. And the reception has nothing to do with any of that. But I agree with you when it comes to – I don't really like people. You know, I don't want to be around 150 hammered people for 5 hours.
I don't mind doing that. Like if KISS is taking the stage.
Yeah.
But if it's just people in suits, not interested.
No, I mean, I'm going to have shorts, flip-flops on and a fucking t-shirt. We're in the woods, in the middle of the woods. That's where the reception is, in the woods.
I don't. I'm allergic to fresh air. We've had that conversation.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I love it outside. I really do. I've got an outside guy sometimes, especially when it's warm.
Yeah. Okay. I like it outside too. If I'm like Disney World,
but not the woods.
But not the woods. Or if I'm on the pool deck on the kids' cruise.
Yeah. Oh, I love pool decks too. I love decks.
You love dicks?
I knew it was coming. I set myself up for it. I should have used a synonym.
Listen, it's okay. If you like dicks, it's who am I?
You a fag? I just like to suck dicks.
One place I might like to go, and I'll have to talk to see if Josh and Greg want to go to this, and maybe even my pal Mike Sanchez down in Carolina, or Kevin. I mean, Kevin Klotzy down in the Carolinas. But there's this place. I never heard of this place. The Carowinds Park?
Never heard of it.
In Charlotte, North Carolina? So they got a new roller coaster that's opening up. I guess their first day is March 28th. But you don't have to wait to take the ride. They released a point of view video here. So here, I'm not going to play the point of view video, but I will just play a little video about what this ride, this roller coaster, is all about. So if you're into roller coasters, and are you into roller coasters, Mike?
I actually just got into roller coasters like 3 years ago. I never rode one until like 3 years ago.
How is that possible?
I never wanted to ride one.
As long as I fit, I love it.
There's certain ones
that are just, I'm way too big. But if I could wedge my big ass inside of there and the bar comes down, I'm all in.
I still won't ride a wooden one.
Really?
Really.
You go on the Cyclone, Coney Island?
I won't ride a wooden roller coaster.
Oh, you're such a wuss.
I am.
We'll break that cherry this year.
Yeah. We'll see.
Here's a brand new coaster, and we'll have to see. Maybe we'll do a whole Mike and Mike trip down to Carowinds. I'll bring my kids to it. I think my wife would love it. My wife's a huge coaster freak. But this is Carowinds Park in Charlotte, North Carolina. But just take a listen to what is opening up in 21 days.
If you're a fan of roller coasters, take a look at this. It's the crazy cool new Fury 325 coaster, debuting March 28th at Carowinds Park in Charlotte, North Carolina. But you don't have to wait until then to take a ride. The park released this point of view video to YouTube. The Fury 325 will be the world's fastest and tallest giga coaster, which means that it has a drop ranging from 300 to 399 feet, completing a full circuit. The ride stands at a crazy 325 feet tall with an 81-degree drop. Not enough for you? The Fury 325 reaches speeds of 95 miles an hour. One commenter on YouTube summed it up by writing, "I get anxiety just watching this."
How epic is that?
That is. That's crazy.
So we'll have to check that out. The Fury 325 roller coaster debuts March 28th at Carowinds Park in Charlotte. Wow. 81-degree drop, 325 feet, and it goes 95 miles an hour.
That's insanity.
That sounds like I think I just heard Sir Ninja Turtles and Sir McGaver just both came simultaneously. Because that's right in their wheelhouse. No, my wife will be moist when she sees this video later on.
Well, I mean, then you might want to light some candles prior to showing her the video then.
That's not a bad idea. You know, yeah. I have candles still from Christmas that I light that I got. I got the I Love or Smell My Nuts candles. I swear to God, I'm not even making it up.
Smell My Nuts candles.
I got Smell My Nuts candles. Yeah, Google that. I'm not kidding. That's what I got. I got a Smell My Nuts candles. Let me see if I can find it now real quick online. Smell My Nuts candle. Here it is. Smell My Nuts candles. It's at, you can get it at Amazon.com. Smell My Nuts mason jar candle. They're actually called Smell My Nuts. I got the Nice Melons candle. So it's like Nice Melons scented candle, and I got the Smell My Nuts candle.
Nice.
You can get them on Amazon Prime. So, and if you do, tell them we sent you, and they can sponsor the show.
Oh, okay. So prior to showing her the video, then you light up some Smell My Nuts candles.
And Nice Melons, because my wife's got a big rack. So it's
Nice Melons, and you make things happen then.
Yeah, the Red Dragon is in town. I'm not like I'm not a Dragon Slayer. I'm getting too old to slay the dragon, so we'll wait. The Red Dragon just landed recently, so we got a ways to go before that clears out.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Right.
Right.
I put my lance away a long time ago when the Red Dragon comes out. He wins. Yeah. He wins.
Yeah.
He breathing fire. I can't handle that.
Yeah.
All right, so let's move on to the news. Let me close out some of these windows. Let me get rid of the walking deaf. So why don't you start off? Should we play the intro music? Let me play the intro music for the video, the clip that we got from Bobby J from the Kiss Cruise has posted about the dude in Florida. I'm sure you saw it already. What am I doing here? You know what the problem is? You know what problem I have today, besides the fact I'm three Bloody Marys in?
What's that?
Is that I'm looking at the Kodo sound clips. And not the Mike and Mike sound clips.
Down to Florida. We welcome you to the Sunshine State. They're kicking back and soaking up the rays every day in Florida.
I love that. I love that music, by the way.
Yeah.
I do.
Absolutely. So, it's great.
Florida man brings neighbor's dead body to lawyer's office. I'm not sure if you saw this, but John Marshall, 52, told attorney Robert Harris that he fatally shot 65-year-old Theodore Hubble Jr. in self-defense after they got into an argument Wednesday. Marshall then pulled his neighbor's body in the pickup truck and drove to Harris's office. Once I learned the facts, I called 911. He said the guy tried to kill him first. In the days before the fatal incident, Harris advised his client to get a restraining order because the man had threatened him over a building on the property in Boquilla. It should be, I'm going to kill you, not Boquilla. The man went up to him and said he wanted to apologize for behavior, and he pulled out a gun, shot him, yada, yada, yada. And he brought him to the lawyer's office. Dude, let me tell you, I killed somebody. I ain't cha-cha-ing to the lawyer's office with the body in the back.
No, I'm not. Like, nobody's seen me until there's no more body.
Right.
Unless it truly was self-defense, and then it's whatever. But if I'm not putting him in the back of my vehicle and bringing him to my lawyer.
Here's a craziness. You want to hear that this goes on? The lawyer said he's distraught. He's a man who fought for his life tonight, and he doesn't change the fact that someone's dead. He was taken to the hospital. He was treated for missing teeth and broken fingers. No charges are filed in the case, said the News Press of Fort Myers. It's the cleanest cut case of self-defense we've ever seen.
Really?
He was facing battery with a deadly weapon charge last year when he hit a 57-year-old handicapped man with his car and drove off. Fail.
Fucking Florida.
Florida. First of all, this guy is still facing aggravated battery with a deadly weapon charge because he ran over a 57-year-old guy in a wheelchair.
And now he's showing up at his lawyer's office with a dead body. And
they're like, you know what? Self-defense.
Clear cut.
Clear cut. The clearest cut we've ever seen.
Yep. Zero evidence. We're not going to investigate it. And just by looking at this situation and the dead body in this guy's truck. Self-defense.
Judge says somebody dig a hole.
Down to Florida.
That's it. There are no laws there.
No laws. Telling you. Retiring there.
Oh, my God. I'm moving now.
Yeah. Yeah. You want to do a death bucket list? Move to Florida.
I'll be done by lunch.
I'll say, look, man, these 10 people attacked the shit out of me. Oh, clear cut.
Clear cut. I'll kill them all. We'll get a mojito.
Yep.
We'll get a mojito. We'll dip our tootsies in the water. Come on. It's the best out there.
Put them in the ground. Let's get a beer, and we'll do a shot, and we're good to go.
Oh, my God. Anyway. Sorry. Give me a new story. Thanks, Bobby, for sending that to us.
And, yeah, no, that was else, excellent.
Send us stuff from Florida or anywhere else. We'd love to hear the stories. And
yeah. You know, like real quick, before I talk about this next ridiculous thing that happened in the state of Wisconsin, but if you listen to this, send us stories. You find a weird story, you know, that blows your mind, a weird video, a weird picture, whatever. Just shoot us a message out on our Facebook page.
And we'll talk about it.
And we'll talk about it.
Just like when my wife posted the fleshlight thing that you can FaceTime the inside of your vagina.
Right. Amazing.
Amazing. Hooks up to your iPad. You insert it. And you can see all the inside and guts.
Right. And obviously, we're not going to find all the stories that's going on in the world. So,
and we might not be able to use every story that's sent to us.
Right.
But if you do send it and we find it intriguing, we'll definitely use it.
Yeah, 100%.
We'll have to get some shit to give away.
Yeah, I mean, I think this year
you should clip some stuff from your office.
Yeah, I should.
That'd be great stuff to give away.
Well, there's samples all the time. Like the other day, they asked me if I wanted something. Like, hey, man, like here's our sample shelf of stuff that we don't sell. Know what I mean? Like these companies want their business, so what they do is they send them boxes of free shit. Because a buddy of mine the other day texted me, he's like, "Hey, man, I need mine is no longer in commission, so can you get me one of these?" And I was like, "Well, let me check the sample shelf.
Why not?
You know."
I think you should send all that stuff to me, and I'll send it out. You should tell them, listen, we'll put something up on the website. We'll call you a sponsor. Just give us the samples.
I really should. I really should talk to my boss about it. I mean, my boss, my direct boss is the owner. So
right. Well, it's a win-win.
Right. Right. It is.
Tell him I need some extra large Profos.
Yeah. there's shelves of those fucking things.
Well, send them to me. I'm tired of buying them from a competitor.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. So we can maybe set that up. That's an offline conversation, but we can send gifts out to people for giving us
stories, or we'll do a contest. We can do some trivia,
and we'll choose the best story, or some trivia. Be awesome.
The opportunities are endless.
It is. Maybe we'll do a T-shirt soon enough. Whatever.
That's next. I gotta
get a shirt made. I always talk about it and.
I love the Kodo shirts that are black with the white.
Oh, it's amazing. They're amazing, and I need one.
Yeah, well, when we do the next order, remind me. I'll make sure you get one.
Yeah. Yeah, no, they're awesome. I love them.
We sold out, which was insane. I mean, I couldn't believe it. The white ones took forever to sell out. I get it. They were cheesy, I guess, but I thought they were cool at the time. And now that we put the black ones up, they sold out like hotcakes.
Yeah, it's a sick shirt, so it's a well-done.
It's easy peasy.
Right. Right,
and I have a guy that'll do them for almost nothing—a couple dollars a clip.
Right.
So we can talk about that offline. So anyway, and when I'm talking about Kodo, I mean KodoMMA.com, my MMA show, which you can listen to on Monday nights, 9 o'clock at KodoMMA.com.
Yes, the plug. Always got to get it in.
The other things too. Make sure you check out ADO Radio. They always check us out. Those guys are blowing up, man. They got a lot of listeners, and they always give us a shout out both here and on.
Yeah, man, they're awesome. Always and. They're always mentioning us. They just retweeted our latest show again. And, I try to do the same to them, as often as possible. And I just have a question for them. And I got to ask them someday soon is what's up with the girl that wears the Eyes Wide Shut mask?
What is that?
You ever see her?
Yeah, I don't understand what it is.
Like her Twitter page is just M. Like she calls herself M, I think. She started following the show out on Twitter and I followed her back.
Did they pass her around like a blow up doll after they puffed some nice sativa?
Actually, I followed her and she followed us back. But I don't get it. Maybe it's just character and that's cool and I understand. I get it. I get characters. But I was just like, man. Like she like has the hoodie up and it's like tied real tight. It's like you can't even see like the color of her skin.
You sure it's not like Skip from ADO or Chris or one of them guys?
It's definitely a woman. It's got to be a woman. And if it's not, I apologize. But it sounds like a woman. But I think she talks on the podcast too. And like her voice is even kind of muffled because she has the mask over her mouth. And it's just, I don't get it.
It's very vagina vendetta.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe it's not my job to get it, but every time I see her, I wait for like Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman to show up and like start an orgy.
Eyes Wide Shut is amazing.
It's at first I thought it was a terrible movie, and then I actually like read up on like what the movie was about, and I watched it again, and it was amazing.
What was it about? It wasn't about just people banging.
No, secret society. It's about.
That's what I thought it was about. It's still not amazing. It's still bizarre.
Well, no, it's just a story. If you like read into it, right? Like Stanley Kubrick was a fucked up dude, and what's a big secret society? Why can't I think of the Masons, right?
Right.
For instance, and they talk about in the story, like you don't know how powerful these people are. If I told you some of the people that were at this party, you would go, you would be, in awe, just at the levels of people that are. Involved in these secret societies, like you would have to read the article that I read. I probably can't do it justice by breaking it down, But, you know, they go into it, and then they go into, like, all the little tricks and all the little colors that they put into the movie and, like, what they mean. And, like, Stanley Kubrick snuck in this and this and this and this into the movie, and it's awesome.
You're so fucking turning me on, baby.
And, but, yeah, I mean, there was definitely some banging in that movie.
A what?
You naughty, naughty boy.
Imagine me at one of those things. My fat ass was walking into one of those orgies.
I'd be visiting them. I'd be in and out in 30 seconds.
I wouldn't. I'd be walking around.
Your balls are showing.
I mean, I'd be a mess. I'd be an absolute disaster.
Did you come yet? No? I tell you, I don't have all day. TikTok, TikTok, TikTok.
You know.
Just like sipping drinks, getting hammered, watching people fuck.
It's ridiculous. I mean, just the thought of me being in there is ridiculous.
Right.
It'd be awesome, though.
Can you find the cat?
Oh, my God. Can we help you, sir?
Boys have a penis. Girls have a vagina.
I mean, that'd be me. Anyway, what the hell were we talking about?
I don't know. All I know is that there's a 30-year-old man that got in trouble for blowing a horse recently.
Wait a minute. That's not what we were talking about. Where the hell did that come from?
I don't know. It's the next thing that's up.
So, wait a minute. What?
No. In Wausau, Wisconsin, a 30-year-old man has been charged with possession of marijuana and blown a horse.
So, what kind of weed is that if you just start blowing the horse?
I don't know. I don't really think it gets into that. But what it says is, you know, court documents obtained by, you know, this website claim that Jared Kreft was found inside a bar.
When I get up for breakfast, there's no oats in the bin, 'cause everything is going out and nothing's coming in. Believe me when I tell you, I have heard the news.
That's Mr. Ed.
Excellent.
Fucking Mr. Ed, boy.
I got those empty feed bag, empty feed bag blues.
Oh, my God. Have mercy. I need another Bloody Mary.
Yeah, it's excellent. I mean, this guy named Jared Kreft was found inside a barn with a marijuana pipe and a jar of petroleum jelly.
Oh, my God. Man, you're making me ill.
He was also wearing a face mask and blue wind pants with holes cut around the crotch and the ass area.
God, you couldn't afford the Prince assless chaps?
Kreft admitted to police that before he was found inside the barn with said animal, which he blew and jacked off, he was viewing horse porn.
My God, was it the same mask the girl wears on ADO Radio?
I highly doubt it.
Okay,
but they might not retweet us anymore.
Why? I think they would treat us more if they were blowing horses. That just show would take a whole different meaning.
Right, right. Smoking weed and blowing horses.
We got to ask them if they would do if they would do that for like research. They got to have somebody that listens to that show that would blow a horse.
Maybe. Kreft was locked up in Marathon County Jail at $2,000 cash bond and faces a judge on Tuesday, which should also make for an interesting item.
I'm speechless.
In other horse news, sex news, back in October, a 19-year-old Floridian jacked off a horse plush toy at Walmart and put the stuffed animal back on the shelf in classic, nah, change my mind fashion.
Oh, my God, it's so awesome.
Down to Florida.
What else we got over there?
Let me see. I got some more stuff up here. How about this guy here? This Albert Clemens Sr. He's lived in Euclid, Ohio for his home for more than 60 years. Always enjoyed it. He bought the place as a newlywed with his late wife, and he said, I'll live and die in this house. But over the past year, Clemens has been living a nightmare, and he wakes up almost every night with his house being pelted with eggs.
85-year-old owner says he has been awakened hundreds of times in the middle of the night by the sound of eggs and other items hitting the front of his house. Robbed by someone using a launching device like this one from an unknown distance north of the home.
The accuracy with which they hit the front door, let's say.
Dude, they're using a cannon, like a potato cannon, and launching it from blocks away. And he's saying the accuracy is amazing because it keeps hitting the front door, blasting it like a cannon.
Is It's tremendous. It almost seems like they zeroed in.
Eggs would probably be, what, 80% maybe or more. We've seen apples, all kinds of produce, apples, oranges, grapefruits, lemons, limes, canned goods like tuna fish soup.
The family contacted Fox 8 News in early January about the serial attacks on their home, and we set up a night vision surveillance camera on the property. But the vandal has not struck since the weather turned cold. Al Clemens and his family fear the egg bomber will return when the weather breaks.
I just want it to stop. It's ridiculous that we have such a situation in the city of Euclid that I really love so dearly.
I fear for his safety. I'm disgusted by the damage.
Dude, they destroyed the front of this house.
Really?
Oh, it's awful. I feel bad for him. He's an old man. Leave him alone.
Right, right.
You want to pull a prank and do it once? Listen, when we were kids, I used to steal. I'm not going to say steal. I used to take couches. Like once or twice a month, they would put couches out or furniture or stuff that they would spend the special truck around in the suburbs to get rid of like stuff like that for garbage.
Right.
And we used to drive around on those nights and take couches and put them all in our music teacher's lawn against his front door. One day he couldn't get out. There was a sleeper sofa that went up past the top of the gutter. He couldn't get out the front door. He had to go out the back door. And he wound up keeping the couch. And he knew it was us, even though he didn't know it was us. We would go and take for sale signs, and we would change the phone number to his number and put it on his front door or put it on his lawn. And then one day he was in his underwear. He called the cops, and my dad went. My dad was a cop because he was sitting there in his skivvies, is what he said, having coffee, and people walked in the front door. thought it was an open house.
No.
On a Sunday morning. And then one time, there's another teacher, Mr. Brown. Did you hear that? Did that pick up on the microphone?
It was a knock. I heard a knock or something.
No, something happened to my iPad, heard me say skivvies, and Siri just said, this is what I found for skivvies on the internet. Take a look.
Oh.
I swear to you.
Awesome.
Oh, my God. I don't know how, whenever I said something where it made the iPad listen to what I was saying, which is very strange. We live in such a strange world.
I thought you had to hit a
I did too, but you don't have to. If you say a certain word, like I guess either Siri or look up, I don't know. I got to be careful what I say now when this kind of thing. It's like an artificial intelligence.
Right.
But anyway, so at Mr. Brown, we would do it all the time, and he would call, and I remember we were all sitting on my kitchen table on like a Saturday afternoon, me and a couple friends, and he called my dad. He was like, ask your kid how much he's getting commission on my house. Because people were showing up thinking it was an open house, and I'm sitting here trying to fucking, you know, work on something in the house, and here's people walking through my living room.
Right.
Awesome.
That is awesome.
But we're not going to sit there and do damage to somebody's house and just pelt it with eggs and fruit, tuna cans. And this guy looks like a sweet old guy, too. He's there 60 years. Leave the guy alone, please.
Right, especially like an old man. Like, it's just...
Please.
Yeah, he's just trying to shoulder dip, live his last few years out.
Guy's 85.
Guy doesn't want to be fucked with. Don't fuck with him.
Right, leave him alone. Go get somebody who's a dick and fuck with them.
Right, go fuck with a church or something.
What else you got?
Well, as you know, March is White History Month.
It is?
At least according to Jim Bogus in Jersey. This was out on NewJersey.com or NJ.com and in Flemington. I'm not sure where Flemington, New Jersey is. Do you know?
I know. I believe it's like Central Jersey.
Okay. So this guy put a sign in his window that says, celebrate your white heritage in March, White History Month, right on the outside of...
Now, is that dissing Black History Month, which is February? Or no?
Well, here. I'll tell you what it says here. It says, Jim, I'm sorry if I'm not pronouncing his last name, Bogus, proprietor of Jimbo's Deli on Main at 22 Main Street, says, no matter what you are, Muslim, Jewish, black, white, gay, straight, you should be proud of what you are. I shouldn't have to feel bad about being white. But a neighbor and former customer, Bakhti Curtis, who is a biracial, doesn't accept that. He said the sign is mocking Black History Month especially the way the T was crossed in the word white. Now, this guy's out of his fucking mind. First of all, this Bakhti person, this Curtis person who's the biracial, it says the cross piece was not right at the top. It was lower down in a style used by the Ku Klux Klan and other white power groups, Curtis said. That cross piece of the T has since been broadened to make – oh, okay. So the picture is the after picture of him changing the T, evidently.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can actually see the top of the T is much thicker.
You know that's terrible.
That is terrible. If that's how that T really was, if it was like the cross, that's awful.
That is awful.
And then since that was brought up to him, the cross piece of the T has been since broadened to make a more traditional, if top-heavy, capital T. On March 3rd, Curtis saw the sign. He was told that it offended him, but got no satisfaction, so he filed a complaint.
It's a disaster.
Yeah, it's just, you know, it goes on and on and on, you know.
Fail.
And, like, what do you think about that, right? Like, I think that that's a topic for, like, an entire show, you know. Not
I don't
when
mind having a white, I guess, a History Month or whatever heritage you belong to. I mean, white is... I think it's better to have like an Irish or an Italian, just like when Cain Velasquez put brown pride, it should be Mexican pride. Because when right. you start segregating yourself by color, to me it's racist. When you go by what your roots are, whether it's Irish, Italian, whatever it is, to me that's more acceptable than just saying, because like then people are going to take it as white power or black power or brown power, you know what I mean?
Right. No,
it's just my opinion. 100%
agree. I'm actually glad that you said that because that's the way that I am too. Like, I think it should be like, you know, African American history or African History Month or African American History Month or
Black History Month is terrible.
It is. I think it's terrible too. I also think White History Month is terrible. You know, there should be, you know, it's
or
not
brown.
About
it shouldn't be a color.
Right. It's not about being proud about being white or black or brown or whatever.
Here's a question. This is a question I've always wanted. One day I will ask Cain Velasquez, who has brown pride on his chest because he's Mexican. And I'm okay with you being Mexican and being a Mexican and proud of being your whatever your culture is or where you come from. You should be proud about it.
Yes.
So, and if you're that proud, or you want to have it tattooed on your skin for life, go at it. That is your choice. But let me ask you a question. If I didn't care enough about my Irish roots to make that a tattoo. If I had Irish pride on my chest, no one will care. But if I have white pride on my chest, people would be ready to burn me at the cross.
Right. 100%. I agree.
But why is it bad for me to have white pride and okay for him to have brown pride?
It's an age-old argument. You know, and it's an argument that I think will go on forever.
I'm going to...
It's different that, you know, like what a minority.
I have a Mexican tattoo artist. I'm going to have him put white pride on my chest.
Like, I don't want to say something then like sound racist because it's not because I'm not racist and I don't want it to come off that way. But it's socially acceptable for minorities.
Absolutely.
To celebrate their color versus not socially acceptable for white people to celebrate their color.
Makes no sense.
It's racist when white people celebrate being white, and it's not racist when others of color celebrate their color, if that makes sense.
It makes complete sense.
Yeah. So it's okay and socially acceptable for these people to do it, but not okay for these people to do it. And it blows my mind. And then that's why color shouldn't be involved in anything. You know, my mom's side of the family is the majority of them are Italians. My dad's side of the family, the majority of them are Germans. I think that there's a little bit of Irish thrown in there somewhere. I don't know where. And then maybe like a little bit of Swedish. But predominantly we're German and Italian, my family. I have no problem with German History Month, with Italian History Month, Irish History Month. You know, fuck, man, the Native American History Month. You know, they fucking don't even get a month. But
what about was it December 7th, Slap a Jap Day.
Yes.
Does that count?
That's awful.
Oh, it is?
Well, I mean, I think we I think we settled that with two bombs, right? But
not a Slap a Jap Day.
Yeah.
You can't walk around just bitch slapping any Japanese folk you see.
Dummy.
Right.
You got your entire country killed.
Terrible. I digress.
Yeah, it's just I don't agree with the white. You know, I don't.
Yeah, it's terrible. But I would. If it's okay to have brown power, it should be okay to have brown pride. It should be okay to have white pride.
Right, and it's not a knock on them. You know, I'm
no.
Not,
but if I came out as like an MMA fighter and I had white pride in my chest, I'd be like, oh, here comes Hitler coming to the cage.
Well, chances are that they wouldn't hire you.
But then why are you hiring him?
They wouldn't even sign you.
If you notice, they cover it up on billboards.
Right. Like, they won't even sign you if you had white pride across your chest. They would make you either get it covered the fuck up with another tattoo, or they would put, like, some, you know, whatever they do in movies, right? Like, to cover up your tattoos. Like, that's what they would do. If you had white pride across your chest, that's what would happen. I assure you. I guarantee it. I would put my bank account on it.
Terrible.
But anyways.
It's terrible. All right, what else we got? I was just, as we were talking, a Florida teenager was fatally hit by a car last week going back to Florida.
The 13-year-old?
Yeah.
Yeah.
She was riding in a vehicle with several of her friends on Saturday night. Her mother, 36-year-old Janice Pedroza, was driving the teens home from Orlando's Central Florida Fair, where Bachman was showing a pig for Future Farmers of America competition. After she dropped off one friend, the remaining children started arguing over who would sit in the front seat. Bachman became so upset, she announced that she was going to walk home. She got out of the car, sat in the middle of the road, and a car came over and ran her over. Unbelievable.
Now, I think they both got hit, right?
What's it say here? Somebody said, get out of here. The next thing you know, bam, she got hit, flew up in the air. It was awful. Yeah, the mother got hit too, but she survived the incident. Bachman was killed.
Yeah, and the 13-year-old was killed. That's terrible.
Awful. Florida.
The fuck goes on down there?
Obviously, we established that. It's a disaster.
I mean, is it the 365-day-a-year, 100% humidity, 100-degree days? Is that what it is?
I don't know.
Is South Florida, like, does it get to people?
It like, must.
Like, Cuba and Haiti so fucked up because it's hot?
I don't know. It's a disaster.
You know?
Yeah, any other news stories?
I don't really.
I have one last one.
Yeah.
Stevie Frohl and Michael Emery, they're from Michigan, not Florida, were sentenced to life for raping a baby.
Oh, God.
A Michigan couple convicted of filming each other sexually abusing a 1-year-old received life in prison Thursday. Steve Frohl. Are we sure his name's not Joseph Smith?
Hi, my name is Joseph Smith, and I'm going to fuck this baby. What?
How? No, no, Joseph. How? Don't fuck the baby. How? Joseph Smith. How? Don't fuck the baby.
Oh. Jesus.
For those of you who don't know, that is from Book of Mormon. And yeah. my wife's friend, Bobby Lopez, won a Tony Award for that play. He also won a Tony Award for Avenue Q. And he wrote the song Let It Go from the Frozen that we used last week.
From Frozen, yeah. Yeah.
The guy's got buku dollars, but he's good friends with my wife, D.
We need to get him on.
He said he would come on. He's a huge Star Wars fan, and he said he'd talk about my Star Wars tats, and he's a cool cat.
Yeah.
Lives in the village.
Don't fuck the baby.
Don't fuck the baby. I mean, if anybody's never seen Book of Mormon, this is a play that's won Tony Awards for Best Play, and it's all about this guy going to Africa and trying to get AIDS out of Africa by fucking babies. It's insane. I can't even do it justice. It's insane. But even look at that.
Don't fuck the baby. How? Joseph Smith. How? Don't fuck the baby.
Suddenly the clouds parted, and Joseph Smith was visited by God.
How? Joseph Smith, do not fuck a baby. How? I'll get rid of your AIDS if you fuck this frog.
This is what goes on Broadway.
I don't get it. It's awesome, though. Like,
it's amazing. You can't even get seats for it, man. It's amazing. Kevin Smith loves it. Howard Stern goes all the time, and this is sold out for like a year.
Wow.
And it's been sold out, and yeah, the guy makes millions of dollars off of this. And he wrote all the songs. And he's a funny cat. And he wrote this with the guys from South Park.
Oh, all right. Was it Trey Parker and something Stone, right?
Yeah, Trey Parker and whatever Stone and
yeah.
And Bobby Lopez. Bobby Lopez is the musical genius behind all this, and he is he took acting classes with my wife, and they became tight. They're Facebook friends. They talk all the time online, and he had a crush on her. I think we might have talked about this on a past show, and was hitting on her. And then, obviously, we got married, and he still, before he got married, was, like, hitting on D. And my dad still will get hammered at certain family functions. He's like, you know, you had that guy, millionaire. He's got 2 Tony Awards. He's got an Oscar. And you took his big ass? Boy, you chose poorly.
That's funny.
That's true. But he's written, like, a bunch. Like, if you look it up, he wrote the, there's the Finding Nemo experience down in Animal Kingdom. And he did the whole musical score for that for Disney. He writes a lot of music for Disney. And the guy's sharp as a tack, funny cat. And he can write stuff for kids, and obviously he can write stuff for adults. I mean, if you watch Avenue Q, it's the same nonsense, just with puppets.
And he's rolling in it.
Oh, my God, he's bathing in $100 bills.
Yeah. He just gets royalty checks. Like, that's like what he does. Like, he just lives off of fucking royalty checks for the rest of, or could. He still does new stuff. But if he wanted to, he could live off of royalty checks for the rest of his life.
Yeah, Google him, Bobby Lopez. And yeah, we should get him on. He said he would come on.
Yeah.
The problem is, this is the problem, Mike. Everybody says they'll come on, but we do the show so early on a Saturday, people would rather come on like a weeknight.
Right, right. No, that's true. I mean, I think that if we're going to do guests, we should schedule it basically around them. Like if they're available, you know, Wednesday night, if they say they're available Wednesday night, then we should do it Wednesday night and just suck it up and do it.
Yeah, for sure.
Because, I mean, I think it's the only way.
The only way you get West Coast guests, because they're all like, dude, I'm not coming on 9 o'clock on a Saturday morning.
It's like fucking 6 here. Fuck you. Yeah. I'm just getting home from the bar.
You're out of your mind.
Yeah. And but no, I agree, because I would like to do more guests more often this year in 2015. You know, it doesn't have to be guests every week, obviously. But I would like to do guests here and there. And, you know, obviously it should be around their schedule and not ours. So, you know.
And they'll all come on, but they tell us when they want to come on. That's the problem.
Right. That's the thing. And that's when it's just like, okay, well, all right. If you can't do it till Wednesday night at 10 o'clock Eastern Standard Time,
right?
I guess that's the time that we got to record it, and then we'll throw it into the next show or just have it as its own episode, you know?
Suck it up, Buttercup.
Absolutely. I agree.
Suck it up. All right, so let me go back to the story here. So they got life. I don't know how to quantify the horror this child was put through. Judge Dennis Lieber said the sentencing on Thursday, which Emery got 3 consecutive life sentences and Frohl received life in prison. Emery came under investigation in February 2013 after police learned that his alleged sexual relationship with a 14-year-old girl. Cops say the offender made contact with the teen through Craigslist, of course, where she was offered her services as a babysitter. Her parents found out, reported to the police. Emery and Frohl fled. They were in Alpine Township in Michigan. They found their computer containing graphic videos, which they investigated. And the investigator said they were almost impossible to watch. To a person, this is the worst. One of the worst sexual child cases I've ever seen. And, yeah, they just said it's a mess. And then when they said Emery apologized to the victim's family. So this wasn't even their kid. Every day I wake up, I wish I could take it back. All I can say is I try to make the future better, make things better somehow. To say I'm remorseful is an understatement, is what he said to the court.
I honestly, I think people like that should get the death penalty.
I mean, I don't know what they did, because all they're saying here, they said Frohl said we did nothing to hurt the victim physically, but admitted that, of course, it's not going to make sense to anybody. It doesn't even make sense to me, she said.
Right.
But if you're that much of a wackadoo, you got to go.
Right. You got to go.
I mean, what's the sense of paying for these people for life? What they did to a child, they admit doing it.
Right.
It's not like they're saying we're falsely accused. I mean, if it was my kid, I would have just killed them.
They would go on the bucket list. But no. I would wait until I was diagnosed. I would just do it.
Yeah, it'd be done deal. I'd be punting their head like Steve Weatherford.
Right. Yeah, it's terrible. I mean, it's tragic. It's you know, this is where I firmly believe in the death penalty. You know, some people say, oh, well, it doesn't solve anything. I'm like, these people shouldn't be on the earth anymore. And our taxpayers certainly shouldn't fucking have to go to them housing them. You know what I mean? And, yeah.
Oh, it's terrible.
Death. Put them in the ground. The world's better off without them.
Oh, my God. All right. That's another happy note that we ended the show on again.
Yeah, I know, right? It's always we always leave people in tears.
It's terrible. Anyway, if you want to send us stuff, go to theothermics.com. All of our social media is on there. And check us out. We're going to have to figure out what we're going to do because I'll be away next weekend. So if you want to do another short show, if you want to do a placemaker, whatever you want to do, we'll talk about that when we wrap this up. But until next week, I'm Mike W.
I'm Mike T.
And we'll be talking to you soon, bitches. Make sure you send us stuff so we can make everybody happy out there. Bitches!
Joseph Smith fucked the frog God gave him, and his head went away. Then a great wizard named Moroni came down from the starship Enterprise.
Joseph Smith, your village is shit. You shall lead the villagers to a new village. Take these fucking golden plates.
Away!
And on the plates were written the directions to a new land, Salt Lake City.
Salt Lake City!
Joseph tried to convince all the villagers to follow him and his golden plates.
Liberation! Equality! No more slavery for Upstate Mormon people! I got the golden plates.
Golden plates!
I gotta lead the people.
We head west.
We gotta stick together. We gotta help each other. And so we climb the mountain.
We head west.
And we cross the river.
We head west.
And we fight the oppression. By being nice to everyone.
We are Mormons.
Not so fast, Mormons. You shall not pass my mountain.
Down from the mountain, look who comes.
The American warlord, Brigham Young.
Yes, I am Brigham Young. I cut off my daughter's clitoris. That made God angry, so he turned my nose into a clit for punishment.
Brigham Young, his nose was a clitoris.
What will you do, Joseph? Will you fight the clitoris man?
Not fight him, help him.
Oh. Joseph Smith took his magical fuck frog and rubbed it upon Brigham Young's clit face. And behold, Brigham was cured.
Joseph Smith, magical AIDS frog.
Brigham Young. Brigham Young was so grateful, he decided to join the Mormons on their journey.
Compassion! Courtesy! Let's be really fucking polite to everyone! I got the golden plates.
Gold plates!
I'm gonna lead the people.
We head west!
We gotta stick together!
Mormons!
Now comes the part of our story that gets a little bit sad.
Oh!
After traveling for so long, the Mormons ran out of fresh water and became sick with dysentery.
Mormon go to the water, water go to the cup. Cup go to the stomach, shit come out the butt. Shit go in the water, water go in the cup. Shit go down the stomach, shit come out the butt.
Oh, fuck!
Oh, no. The prophet Joseph Smith is now getting sick.
Shit go in the water go in the cup. Cup go to the thirsty, shit go to the stomach. Blood come out the butt, blood go in the water go in the cup. Cup go to the throat, shit blood in the stomach. Shit blood in the mouth, shit blood on the inside. Water come out the butt.
Brigham Young, you must take the golden plates and lead the Mormons to the promised land. Desperation, mortality, loss of faith. I got the golden blade.
Golden.
I gotta lead the people.
Even though their prophet had died, the Mormons stuck together and helped each other and were really nice to everyone they came across. And then one day, the Mormons finally found Salt Lake City.
Salt Lake City!
And there, the Mormons danced with Ewoks and were greeted by Jesus.
Welcome, Mormons! Now, let's all have as many babies as we can and make big Mormon families!
Listen to me, Mike. Your self-esteem is low right now.